Hello students, I am VLN Swarupani, lecturer in biochemistry from
Sri Venkateswara College of Arts and Sciences, which is affiliated to Adikavi Nanaya University. So, in this class, I would like to discuss about second BSc third semester biochemistry paper, that is enzymology and bioenergetics, and from this paper we are discussing fourth unit topics, and this is our next topic, that is oxidation reduction reactions. Okay, so we are going to see about this oxidation reduction reactions with proper and suitable examples. Okay, this is a very important essay question regarding in the exam point of view. So let's start this topic, oxidation reduction reactions. Okay, an oxidation reduction or redox reaction is a type of chemical reactions that involves a transfer of electrons between two spaces. Okay, this is the important oxidation reduction reactions, and these are a kind of chemical reactions which will be involved in the transfer of electrons between two species. There will be transfer of electrons between two species, and we call that particular chemical reaction as oxidation reduction reaction, or we can also call them as redox reactions. Okay, an oxidation reduction reaction is any chemical reaction in which the oxidation number of a molecule, an atom or ion changes by gaining or losing an electron. Okay, so what happens in this oxidation reduction reaction? During this chemical reaction, there will be change in the oxidation number of molecule or oxidation number of atom or oxidation number of the ion. Okay, it will be changed. Okay, and how this will change? By gaining or by losing an electron, by gaining an electron or by losing an electron, any of the change might be occurred. Okay, and these all these all things will be happen in the oxidation reduction reactions. Okay, redox reactions are common and vital to some of the basic features of life, including photosynthesis, respiration, combustion and corrosion or rusting. So these are the few important metabolic ways in our body, like photosynthesis. Of course, this photosynthesis is mostly meant for the plants, but apart from plants, this respiration, combustion and corrosion or rusting, these are the important characters. Okay, these are the important characters, and all these processes of photosynthesis, respiration, combustion, corrosion or rusting, they in all these processes, this redox reactions are very common and very important. Okay, and this is the basic this is important for the basic functions, like this, all these important mechanisms. Okay, there is a specific type of chemical reaction called oxidation reduction reactions or redox reaction. In these reactions, electrons are transferred from one reactant to another. So simply, electrons are lost from one substance and gained by another. So these are special type of chemical reactions, and we call them as oxidation reduction reactions or redox reactions. And these reactions, in these reactions, what happens? Electrons will be transferred from one reactant to the other. Electrons transfer is the major concept related to this oxidation reduction reactions. Okay, what happens in this oxidation reduction reactions? Transfer of electrons from one reactant to another. Okay, and these electrons will first substance will lose an electron and the second substance will gain that electron. Okay, so in this manner oxidation reduction reactions will be carried. Oxidation refers to the loss of electrons from substance, while reduction refers to the gain of electrons by a substance. So in this, oxidation is nothing but loss of electrons from one substance, and reduction means gain of electrons by one substance, and both the aspects will happen at the same time, and that's why we call them as oxidation reduction reactions. Okay, and this is a simple type of chemical reaction called oxidation reaction or redox reaction, and these two processes cannot occur without the other. That being said, if there's a reduction reaction, there must be an oxidation reaction. If there's an oxidation reaction, there must be a reduction reaction. That means both the oxidation and reduction. Oxidation means removal of electron, and reduction means gain of electron. Both the reactions should be done at the same time, and with the absence of reduction, there will be no completion, there will be no proper oxidation, and with the absence of oxidation, there will be no proper reduction reaction. So to complete that particular task, both the oxidation and reduction should be carried followed by each other. Okay, adding electrons is called reduction because the overall charge is reduced. More electrons means the substance become more negative. Okay, adding electrons is called as reduction, and because of this, overall charge will be reduced, and more electrons means the substance become more negative. Okay, and if you see an example, for example, carbohydrate typically has 6 protons. Carbohydrate typically has 6 protons, 6 neutrons and 6 electrons. Okay, if you take carbon as example, it has 6 protons, 6 neutrons and 6 electrons. And if we reduce carbon, if we reduce carbon, it means it will gain an electron. Okay, it will gain an electron. And if you remember, the electrons are negative, and adding another electron would make 7. And the carbon atom would become more negative in charge, and we should say that the carbon's overall charge has decreased, or it has been reduced, Okay, so if we take carbon as example, it has 6 protons, 6 neutrons and 6 electrons. Okay, note that 6 protons, 6 neutrons and 6 electrons, 6p, 6n and 6e. And on reduction, it gains an electron. That means one more electron is being added. What happens then? Electrons are negative in charge. Okay, so adding another electron then what will happen? Electrons will be 7, okay? 6 protons, 6 neutrons and 7 electrons will be there. And as this electrons are negative in charge, this carbon molecule with 7 electrons will be more negative, okay? This will be more negative. And there will be carbon's overall charge will be decreased or it has been reduced. And if you see a redox reaction example, H2 plus F2, hydrogen plus fluorine gives rise to hydrofluorine, that is 2HF. Here H2 will contain 2 hydrogen molecules along with 2 protons, okay? 2 protons of hydrogen and 2 electrons will be there. And this fluorine will also contain 2, it will receive, what will happen? By combining with HF, this will, F2 plus 2 electrons will be converted into 2F minus, okay? And by combining these reactions, you can see H2 and 1F2 gives rise to 2H plus 2F minus, okay? So, if you see the reaction balance here, hydrogen molecule is will carry 2 electrons, okay? And here, fluorine will receive that particular electron and it will be more negative, okay? Finally, 2HF will be produced. And the easiest way to fully understand redox reaction is to look at some examples. So, let's start by looking at the reaction that forms table salt, okay? Table salt means nothing but sodium chloride, sodium Na plus and Cl minus. So sodium is oxidized and loses an electron to have a +1 charge. Okay. What the sodium will do? Sodium will get oxidized. Oxidization means removal of an electron or loss of an electron. Okay. By losing, what will happen? It will be turned into 1 positive charge, okay? +1 charge will be increased by removal of 1 electron from the sodium, okay? And which means while chlorine is reduced because it gains the electron and will have the -1 charge, okay? The sodium, what it will do? It will lose an electron and it will be increased by +1 charge, okay? Whereas the chlorine, which will gain the electron, will be decreased by -1 charge, okay? And the redox reaction creates 2 ions with positive charges that are attracted to one another and create sodium chloride, which is a table salt, okay? So, by this redox reaction, what will happen? 2 opposite charges will be attracted. So, these 2 charges will be positive charge and negative charge will be attracted. And that means Na, sodium, which is a positive, which carries a +1 charge, and chlorine, which one carries minus one charge, both positive and negative charges which are present on the sodium and chlorine respectively will get attracted to each other, and finally sodium chloride or table salt will be produced. So oxidation is defined as the loss of electrons and reduction as the gain of electrons, and this may be illustrated by the interconversion of ferrous ion to ferric ion. If you see one more example related to iron, okay, related to iron, it has a ferrous form, that is Fe plus 2, and ferric form, that is Fe plus 3. So how these two forms are interconverted? By removal of By oxidation, what will happen? It will remove an electron. It will remove an electron from the Fe plus 2. By removing, what will happen? Plus 1 charge will be added, making it a Fe plus 3. Okay, making it Fe plus 3. And the electron will be accepted by the reducer compound. Okay, and what will happen again? By removal of one electron, Fe plus 2 will be produced. Okay, by removal, that means minus 1 will be convert, minus 1 will be applied to this ferric. Okay, then it will be converted into again ferrous form. So this is how ferrous and ferric forms are interconverted based on this oxidation reduction reactions. Oxidation reduction reactions. And the electrons lost in the oxidation is accepted by an acceptor, which is said to be reduced component. So whatever the component receives the lost electron or loosed electron from the first component, that particular component is called as reduced component. And thus the oxidation reduction is tightly coupled process. Oxidation reduction is a tightly coupled process, and both oxidation and reduction follow each other. Okay, that means oxidation is the removal of electron, and the electron will be received by the reduced component, and by removal of this electron, this particular component is converted into more positive form, and the reduced component, by taking the electron, by taking the lost electron from the oxidized component, it will achieve the reduction process, and it will be reduced further. Okay, and both the reactions will be followed with each other. Okay, and the oxidation of NADH to NAD plus couples with the reduction of FMN to FMNH2. So here one more example. Okay, FMN to FMNH2 production. Okay, if you see the diagram, NADH plus H plus is converted into NAD plus. Okay, is converted into NAD plus, and during this process, 2 hydrogen plus 2 electrons will be produced. That means hydrogen ions will be plus 1 will be taken, and 2 electrons will be lost by this NADH. Finally, NAD plus will be produced. Okay, and in simultaneously to this NADH plus H plus to NAD plus reaction, FMN to FMNH2 reaction is followed. Okay, so FMN is converted into FMNH2. So this is how oxidation and reduction will be occurred in a linked manner. Okay, in the above diagram, if you see, there are 2 redox pairs, that is NADH, which means along with FMNH2. So these 2 are redox products, and whereas the redox pair differ in their tendency to lose or gain of electrons. Okay, and we should also see about redox potential related to this oxidation reduction reactions. Redox potential related to this oxidation reduction reactions. And here this redox potential is mentioned with E naught. So this is denoted with E naught, and the oxidation reduction potential, or simply redox potential, is a quantitative measure of the tendency of a redox pair to lose or gain of electrons. Okay, so that means tendency to lose or gain, that means ability or its ability to lose or gain by that redox pair is measured, okay, is quantitatively measured with this redox potential or oxidative redox potential, okay. And the redox pairs, that means redox pairs means these will carry oxidation and reduction, okay. So one particular compound is related for the oxidation and the second compound is related for the reduction, and we call those two component collectively as redox pairs, okay. And in these redox pairs only we'll calculate the redox potential based on the tendency of those redox pairs to lose or gain electrons, and we calculate this redox potential in a quantitative manner, okay. Quantitative measurement will be carried based on this redox potential, okay. And the redox pairs are assigned specific standard redox potentials at pH 7 and 25 degrees centigrade. So at optimum temperature and at optimum pH, optimum temperature value is 25 degrees centigrade and optimum pH value is 7.0. okay, so these are the optimum values for temperature and also the pH, okay. And at these particular optimum temperature and pH, redox pairs will show standard redox potential. A specific standard redox potential will be shown at these particular values, okay. And we calculate them as E naught volts. We calculate them as E naught volts. And the more negative redox potential represents a greater tendency to lose electrons. On the other hand, a more positive redox potential represents a greater tendency to accept electrons. So here, the more negative redox potential, what it will represent? Greater tendency to lose electrons. That means that particular compound with negative redox potential, it can easily lose the electrons, okay. It can easily lose the electrons. And more positive redox potential values shown by the component, it can easily accept the electrons, okay. So if any compound have negative redox potential, it means it is ready to lose electrons. It can easily lose electrons. Whereas if a compound has positive redox potential, then it can easily accept, okay. And the electrons flow from a redox pair with more negative E naught to another redox pair with more positive E naught, the redox potential E naught is directly related to the change in the free energy. So here also this electron transfer, okay, loss of electron or gain of electron is also related with the free energy change, okay. So again, this is related to the free energy change, and this is directly related. That means both, if energy is lost, then it will lead to change in the free energy. That will be increase in the change in the free energy. And free energy change, standard free energy change can be denoted with what it is denoted? Delta G naught. It is denoted with delta G naught. Okay. And see the values of different components here. Different components, redox pairs, E naught values are mentioned here. H2 plus or H2 ion has minus 0.42 E naught volt. Okay. Redox potential. Okay, its redox potential value is minus 0.42. So minus value, it is being denoted with minus value means what it is? It is a ready acceptor. It is a ready acceptor. And Na plus or NADH. So this is another redox pair. And it has minus 0.32 redox potential value. And FAD and FADH2 has minus 0.22 redox potential value. Whereas pyruvate and lactate, okay, it has minus 0.19 redox potential value. And coenzyme Q have plus 0.10 redox potential. So these are the different redox potentials of this particular redox pairs. Okay, so this is about oxidation reduction reactions. And now let's see about free energy and concept of free energy. So energy is defined as the capacity to do work to bring about a change when a reaction occurs. Energy is given out or taken in. So energy is free energy, or energy is the capacity to do work. Okay, by this work, what will happen? There will be a change in the reaction. Okay, reaction, and energy will be given out. That means out of the biological system or taken in into the biological system. If the energy is given out, we call it as exergonic reaction. And if we take in, it is endergonic reaction. So this is energy. So what is free energy? Energy means it is a capacity to do work. But what is free energy? So this is the energy released by a reaction and free to do work. Okay, whenever a reaction happened and change in that energy happened, here exergonic or endergonic action may occur. That means energy may be given out or energy may be taken in. So if exergonic reaction happened and energy is given out, okay, so free energy is energy is given out, and now we call it as free energy. And the energy released by a reaction, and that particular energy is free to do work, and that particular energy is free to do work, and we call it as free energy, and we represent it with capital G. Okay, and it is represented with capital G, and it is energy available to do useful work. It is the energy available to do useful work. And if you take a small example, pumping of ions across a concentration gradient form bonds between different atoms. Okay, this is an example. That means whenever a pumping of ions through the membranes based on the concentration gradient. So concentration gradient means on the one side of the membrane there will be highest amount of the ions, and on the other side those ions will be very less. To bring the balance in those ions, what will happen? Pumping of ions will be carried to bring about the equilibrium in this concentration gradient. Concentration gradient means concentration of one particular component will be high onto the one side of the membrane, and there will be very less concentration of that particular ion on the other side. Okay, so this is the example. And now let's see about concept of free energy. So we have seen what is energy and what is free energy. Now let's see concept of free energy.
Okay. The energy actually available to do work is known as free energy. Okay. So the energy which is released and which is ready to do work, okay, is called as free energy. And changes in free energy can be denoted with delta G. Change in the free energy is denoted with delta G. We denote free energy with capital G. And change in that particular free energy is denoted with delta G. Okay. And these particular change of free energy is a variable for predicting chemical reaction. So, based on the change in this particular free energy, we can identify the we can understand more about the chemical reaction. Okay, that means if there is a change in that particular free energy, that means their energy might be utilized or energy might be released. Okay, energy may be taken from the outer environment or given to the outer environment. So, by observing the change in that particular free energy, we can identify whether it is an exergonic reaction or an endergonic reaction. Okay, and the reaction can occur spontaneously if there are accompanied by decrease in the free energy during a chemical reaction and heat may be released or absorbed. Here, one important point is heat is a form of energy. Heat is a form of energy. So, we can't take heat as a energy source, but it is a form of energy. But we consider this heat as a energy form, and heat will not help us to do work, okay? But it will be liberated after the after work as the source of energy, okay? So that, and here one more thing, that is standard free energy, which we are representing with delta G naught. This is a important aspect to indicate the free energy change with regarding to reactant and also to the product, okay? So this will help us to know about the energy change with the reactants and with the product. So in some conditions, if we see and if we calculate the energy in the reactants and also the energy levels with the products, we can know the correct difference or correct free energy change, and this can be done at concentration of 1 mole per liter at 7 pH. Okay. And here, how this free energy change is related to exergonic and endergonic. Let's see that. And this delta G, that means free energy change, will be represented with a negative sign if it loses free energy. Okay. So, if it is losing free energy, what it means? It is a exergonic reaction. So, exergonic reactions, and in exergonic reaction, free energy change is represented with negative sign, in which loss of free energy will be occurred. Okay. So, this is the relationship between free energy change and the exergonic reaction. Okay. And the next point is about endergonic reaction. The free energy change, that is delta G, will be represented with positive sign. Okay. And which means energy is supplied to the reactants to occur, to undergo the reaction. Those reactants are being supplied with the energy. Okay. And this particular reaction is said to be endergonic. That means endergonic reactions are nothing but which take energy from the outer environment or from the surroundings of the biological system. And these particular reactions and the free energy change in that particular endergonic reaction is represented with positive sign. Okay. And what if both reactants are reactant and products are in a balanced state? Obviously free energy delta G is denoted with
is denoted with zero, as both reactants and products are at equilibrium state. Okay, so this is how we can identify exergonic and endergonic reactions. Okay, and whenever this particular components are acting at constant temperature and pressure, this delta G will be dependent on the concentration of reactants and products. Okay, so at constant temperature and constant pressure, delta G, okay, delta G will be depending on the concentration of reactants and concentration of products. So coming to exergonic and endergonic reactions, what will happen? There, based on the variation in the temperature and pressure, they may take energy or they may release the energy. But what if all the factors responsible for that reaction, like temperature and pressure, are constant, then what will happen? This free energy change will depend on the concentration of reactants and products. Okay, based on the concentration of reactants, concentration of products will be formed. Okay, and based on this concentration, this delta G will be dependent. Okay, there will be the change of free energy will depend on concentration of these, and this can be mathematically represented as delta G is equal to delta G naught plus RT log B by A, where delta G is the free energy change and delta G naught is the standard free energy change and R is the pressure, okay, gas constant. It will represent gas constant, and T is the absolute temperature at 273 kelvins, and logarithm of B by A. B is the concentration of product and A is the concentration of reactant. Based on this mathematical equation, we can calculate the free energy change. Okay, so and the next topic is enthalpy. So first of all, this word enthalpy was taken from the Greek word. So basically it is derived from a Greek word, that is enthalpin. Okay, so Greek word enthalpin, from which this enthalpy is derived. And in Greek language, meaning of enthalpin means warm or heat. That means this is representing the temperature. The word enthalpy representing the temperature in Greek, and this is enthalpy word is derived from that. And this is denoted with delta H. Okay, it is denoted with delta H, and this is always represented with negative sign if there is a heat height release. Okay, during the reaction, okay, during any chemical or biological reaction, if heat releases, okay, as this if we see the word itself, we can understand this factor will explain about the temperature condition of the reaction. Okay, so during a reaction if energy is released, that particular reaction's enthalpy is denoted with negative sign. That means it is a release, it is losing the energy in the form of heat. That's why we use negative sign. Okay, and obviously any reaction which is losing energy is a exothermic reaction. And if the particular biological or chemical reaction is taking heat or energy from the surroundings, then it is represented with positive sign. We call it as endothermic reaction. And SI units for this enthalpy is, SI unit means it is a measuring unit. SI unit for this enthalpy is joule. Okay. And enthalpy for ideal gases and incompressible solids and liquids doesn't depend on pressure. Whereas for remaining all components, this enthalpy is also dependent on the pressure. Okay. Basically, all these reactions or endothermic or exothermic reactions are dependent on two major factors, that is temperature and pressure. But coming to this enthalpy in ideal gases, incompressible solids and in few liquids, this doesn't depend on pressure. Okay. And in remaining all components, it depends on pressure also. Okay. And the enthalpy can be denoted with the mathematical formula delta H is equal to U plus PV. Okay. Delta H is nothing but enthalpy itself. Okay. And U is the internal energy of the system. P is nothing but pressure of the system. V is the volume of the system. And this is used to calculate the enthalpy. So, here there is a mathematical equation to study the relationship between change of free energy. Okay, the concept what we discussed earlier, that is free energy change, which is denoted with delta G, and also enthalpy delta H, and one more concept we are going to discuss, that is entropy, that is delta S. So, the relationship between these three concepts, that is change of free energy, enthalpy and entropy, can be denoted with delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Here delta G, delta H, delta S, all you know. Okay, delta G is free energy change, delta H is enthalpy, and delta S is entropy, and here T represent absolute temperature. Okay, that's it. And the next topic is entropy. Okay. So, what is the sign representing this entropy? It is delta S. We represent this entropy with delta S. So, here free energy change is the released energy which is ready to do work. And entropy means it is nothing but the heat released, okay, heat released during the reaction is calculated as entropy. And what is enthalpy? So, what is entropy? It is the change in the randomness or disorder of the reactants and products, okay. That means it will represent the change in the randomness of the reactants and products. That means how randomly these reactants will be change it to different forms, or how randomly these products will be changed into other forms. So, this is represented with entropy. Okay. So, during any reaction, firstly what will happen? Reactant will combine with the enzyme responsible for it. Okay. So, immediately what will happen? Enzyme substrate complex will be formed. And how randomly this particular enzyme substrate complex is converting into product, this can be represented with entropy. Okay, hope you got the point. Okay, entropy attains a maximum as a reaction approaches equilibrium. So, reaction equilibrium means here quantity of reactants and quantity of that particular product will be at equilibrium, and at that point this entropy will be to its maximum level. That means it will be very high. And the reactions of biological system involves a temporary decrease in entropy. Okay, biological systems involve a temporary decrease in entropy. That means before acquiring equilibrium, this entropy will be very less. Okay, at the greater the this particular randomness, there will be higher the entropy. And decrease of regulatory in structure would mean increase in entropy. Okay, that means regulation in the decreased regulation of the structure may lead to increase in entropy. Okay, so structure regulation, if it is inhibited, then obviously that particular compound will act properly and entropy will be increased. And this entropy is always proportional to the temperature. It is always inversely proportional to the temperature. That means if entropy is increasing, temperature will decrease. If temperature is increasing, entropy will decrease. So these two factors will act in a opposite direction. So delta is inversely proportional to 1 by T. Okay. And increase in temperature will decrease the entropy. And that's why we represent this as delta S inversely proportional to 1 by T. And total entropy change, that is TS total, can be easily calculated of a system and the surroundings based on a equation called delta S total is equal to delta S system plus delta S surroundings less than 0. So this is a equation which is helpful in the calculation of total entropy change in the system and for the surroundings. Okay, by using this equation we can calculate total entropy in the system and surroundings. Okay, so this is for this class. So while listening to the class, please take the material with you provided for you, and if you have any doubts, please contact me. Thank you, students.